We're going to remember exactly what happened 150 years ago. With the largest and greatest assault in the history of the Army of the Potomac. One of the great life and death struggles of the war. As we go on this walk in the dark, I ask that you be extremely careful. Be mindful of your surroundings. We are going to be going down a wooded lane, a trail. Then we're going to be heading out into the field between the Union and Confederate lines. And we will be crossing the Confederate lines, hopefully at the exact moment that the Union soldiers did that. In the process of this, I want you to be careful. I want no casualties today. So, be mindful that the ground is uneven, that you are walking in the dark, that we will be deep in the woods on a trail, but then we're going to be cutting across a field that doesn't have a trail. When we get to the Confederate earthworks, I ask that we cross at the bridge. I know that's going to be a choke point. I know it's going to slow us down. But we are not going to do anything until everybody is inside the earthworks. So we will take our time. We will be respectful of the trenches. And we will not walk on them. We are also in the inhabitants, or in the habitat, I should say, of a number of denizens who live on this battlefield. So, there are creepies, there are crawlies, there are slitherers, that none of them will be out to see us. They don't want to see us, we don't want to see them. But when this tour is over, I want you to check to make sure that you don't have any ticks. We don't want you taking home any unwanted souvenirs. So, be careful, be mindful. Check. And with that, let's begin. Beth?
Who's willing to head forward and see what that noise was?
Me!
Bigfoot.
All right, first question. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Yes, great. Now, I think at this point, it's worth noting that we have walked you down a narrow roadway right into the woods. Some of you have flashlights. At this point, I'm going to ask you to turn them off.
Off!
Off.
Off!
Unless you find yourself in a safety hazard, I want us all to get an idea of what it feels like to be out here with absolutely no light. So take a moment and look around. How many of you have any idea where you are? You can raise your hand and I won't see it. This darkness that we're all surrounded by is extremely instrumental as we try to understand the experience of soldiers and officers. And this morning, 150 years ago, at this very moment, how do you lead men in the darkness? How do you have any idea where you're going? And especially when you don't know where you're supposed to be going, how do you find it in this kind of darkness? The men are going to write about their experience quite extensively on the evening of May 11th and the early morning of May 12th. John Haley, the 17th Maine, wrote, "When darkness set in, it was black. We had orders to move about 10 o'clock, but in what direction we could not tell. We marched for several hours in what appeared to be a southerly direction, and then stumbled into a camp of slumberers. The first indication we had of their presence was a terrific string of imperious oaths. We moved right on without pause. Soon we arrived at another camp, and as they had no fires or sentries posted, we marched over them as well. Knocking down stacks of guns and treading on heads and other portions of human anatomy. The air was sulfurous with their responses. So it is so dark out here that as the Union forces, men of the Union Second Corps, are marching into place, the evening of May 11th into the early morning hours of May 12th, they are walking over their comrades, quite literally. Another soldier said it did not take long to obey the order to march. Each one had only to rise from the earth, shake himself in vain to get rid of the chills that were ever coursing up and down the spine on nights like this, wring the water out of his shoes, lift the cold, heavy musket from the stack, and all was ready. That doesn't sound like a very pleasant preparation to march. An officer in the 12th New Jersey wrote, "I have never before suffered such acute agony from any cause. My eyes would close, do what I would to prevent it, and in order to escape a fall from my horse, I would lean forward and wind my arms about his neck. But the poor brute's head would almost invariably sink lower and lower until I would find myself sliding head foremost toward the earth." These men are ordered to start marching late in the evening. That means they have gotten even less sleep than all of you have. They are extremely tired. They are absolutely exhausted. And they're ordered to march a long ways to get into place. John D. Black of the 145th Pennsylvania wrote, "The movement was necessarily slow, with frequent halts, at which time the men, worn out by loss of sleep and the terrible nervous and physical strain they had endured during the past 8 days, these men had been in combat for 8 days, would drop down for a moment's rest and be asleep almost as soon as they touched the ground. So however tired you all might be feeling, go ahead and multiply that by about 100. These men are falling asleep as soon as they stop. They're collapsing on the side of the road as quickly as they can. They're suffering from extreme exhaustion, the darkness that we can see all around us, and a nice healthy amount of drizzle, which means they do have to wring out their shoes before they put them on. The march to battle is an extremely miserable one for the Second Corps, and the officers are besieged by confusion. They don't know where they're going, they're not entirely sure why, and they're supposed to lead all of their men into place. Francis C. Barlow wrote, "I remember well the loudly expressed indignation of those officers at being sent to conduct an important movement when they had no information whatever as to the position or strength of the enemy, or indeed upon any of the important points, and at times a sense of the ludicrous, of the absurdity of the situation prevailed over the feeling of responsibility and indignation." So as officers, these men understand, they realize that they are responsible for the lives of those beneath them. How are they supposed to lead when they do not know where to go? When they're facing darkness and exhaustion, how do they handle the weight of responsibility when they're not properly equipped with information to succeed? William Driver, an assistant adjutant general to Winfield Scott Hancock, commander of the Union Second Corps, wrote, "The intense darkness, pouring rain, and muddy, heavy roads, with the uncertainty regarding the direction and location of the point to be reached, formed just the combination required to produce a brilliant display of grumbling by officers and men." So these officers will not be silent in their march about how they're feeling about this situation. Barlow continued, "Captain Miles and Colonel Brooke, commanding two of the brigades of the division, rode with me at the head of the column and were loud in their complaints of the madness of the undertaking. The former," that would be Captain Miles, "the former was so emphatic in his indignation that I was at last compelled to interfere and tell him to be quiet." I'm sure that none of you have ever experienced a situation in which you were so frustrated by the lack of information that you simply let loose your emotions and ideas and feelings upon those around you. But these men certainly did. The key feelings described here are indignation and responsibility. because these men know who will suffer the consequences of the officers not knowing the details of the march. These men are going to bear the brunt of their officers' misinformation or lack of information. Leads us to ask, why does Miles have to be silenced? These men truly don't know where they're going. Why can't they complain about it? Well, who might be listening to Miles as he goes on and on about how much he doesn't know? If you are a man in the ranks and you over here, how are you going to feel about this attack and this march? You might well start to feel rather demoralized. And so the officers instead turn to some dark humor in order to cope with the confusing situation and their lack of understanding. Barlow wrote, as we staggered and stumbled along in the mud and intense darkness, and I vainly sought for information, the absurdity of our position, that we were proceeding to attack the enemy when no one even knew his direction, and we could hardly keep on our own legs, appealed to me very strongly as I listened to the conversation of Colonel Morgan, one of their staff officers and guides, who was what might be called a profane swearer, and his criticisms on, quote, the conduct of the war. This paints a very fantastic scene, one that we can all relate to. I think just about everybody has been in a situation so painful that it's absolutely ridiculous. He continues by saying, it was an exquisitely ludicrous scene, and I could hardly sit on my horse for laughter. I remember that I finally said to Colonel Morgan, for heaven's sake, at least face us in the right direction so that we shall not march away from the enemy and have to go around the world and come up in their rear. This shows the extreme level of confusion among Union officers. But really, it's a pretty terrifying circumstance. You're stuck in the mud right before a massive assault and you are lost. But it's a fascinating response from these officers leading the men. A very human response. They cope with the chaos and confusion by seeing the situation as ludicrous and by laughing at it. So it shows a lot of how the war has affected these men to this point. At a point when maybe a few years ago they would have been panicking, instead they are adapting and they are laughing. But it shows that they are facing the very real potential of death and that they are intimately familiar with it by this point. And they choose to cope with it by laughing at it. Frank?
May 8th, 1864, the Union and Confederate armies met in a spontaneous clash here at Spotsylvania. Ulysses S. Grant and Robert E. Lee were engaged in a foot race to the crossroads, a foot race that neither one knew they were engaged in, a foot race that the Confederate Army won just by dumb good luck. They won by a matter of feet and minutes. And the Confederates knew they had been lucky. May 10th, these woods literally rang with battle at its most intense. Emory Upton launched an assault against the Confederate mule shoe that overwhelmed a portion of the line. And Robert E. Lee had to throw himself into the breach, trying to rectify the situation. That day, Ulysses S. Grant thought that they might be lucky. He was heard to say, a brigade today, a corps tomorrow. And that is what set us on this trail tonight. On May 11th, 1864, 19,000 Union soldiers were extracted from the far Union right, out beyond the entrance to this battlefield, and spirited behind the lines to get to a jump-off spot for an attack on May 12th. It was a miserable night. It rained terribly. What you can see is far better
than what the soldiers experienced 150 years ago. Several hundred yards to your right is the Confederate line. During this night, as much as the Union Army wished to move stealthily, there is just too much incidental noise that accompanies 19,000 men on the march. Their noise became so painfully evident that the Confederates could mark their progress across their front. Union bands went down into the front trenches to serenade the troops at midnight. If listening to Hail Columbia at midnight in a rainstorm does not sound suspicious to you, you're in the wrong business. As far as the Confederate intelligence is going, they know full well that the Union Army is on the march. They know that the Union Second Corps has pulled out from the other side of Spotsylvania. They know in front of you that the Union Ninth Corps has withdrawn northward towards Fredericksburg, putting the Ny River between them and Spotsylvania. And putting these pieces together, Robert E. Lee has come to the conclusion that the Union Army is retreating back to Fredericksburg. They had anticipated this, they had expected this for several days now. The losses have been grueling, punishing battle, and other Union armies had blinked in these woods before and withdrew. Now it appeared Ulysses S. Grant and George Gordon Meade were doing the exact same thing. As Lee met with his generals on the evening of the 11th, he had several conferences. As he talked to the Third Corps troops, he was told that General Grant had no ability, that he only knew frontal assaults and costly endeavors. But Robert E. Lee, who would have agreed 1 week ago, changed his mind. For on the evening of the 11th, he quietly remarked, "Gentlemen, if you ask me, General Grant has handled his affairs quite well up to this time." So he has respect for this man. He understands that the Union Army is on the march, but there is also opportunity to strike at them before they get to Fredericksburg, if indeed they are retreating. The Confederates are preparing this night to leave their trenches and pursue the retreating Union Army. Orders have gone out telling the men to get ready for the march. The Confederate Second Corps, which is in the tip of the mule shoe, is physically the furthest away from any road network out of Spotsylvania. They were ordered to pull out this very night, in this very darkness. But it was raining, it was miserable, and the men in the trenches had shelter halves draped across their earthworks to keep them dry. Richard Stoddard Ewell appealed to let them stay, that the infantry could catch up in the morning if necessary. And the order was rescinded. But artillery, which was profound in the tip of the mule shoe, would find it very difficult to move in a timely manner. And this night, they were pulled out and sent to the courthouse, sent to the road network, that they might pursue a Union retreat. General A.P. Hill is not in command at this point of the Third Corps. He is sick, but he has stayed with the Army, and he was talking to Lee. And he said it would be best that they stay in the trenches and make Grant come to them. That they could put up with this all day long, day after day. And it would suit them very well, he said. And General Lee's answer was, no, this will not do. We must get into the open and strike them a blow. We must decide this on the battlefield. For if we stay in the trenches, it will become a siege. And then a matter of time. Time against the Confederates. So this very night, Union and Confederate soldiers are stirring, preparing, moving, ready to leave this place. We're ready to see an entirely new part of this place. Confusion reigns inside the Confederate works as well as they do outside. The tip of the mule shoe is just a couple hundred yards away. Allegheny Ed Johnson's division. We're camped there. And much to the surprise of General Johnson, sometime in the night, he watched his artillery vanish. The only thing that made his line strong was artillery. And the one thing that made it strong has now left without anyone telling Johnson why. So he can only wait, watch, and listen as the night starts to end and day begins. Shall we? Onward!
The confusion that these Union officers were facing as they were forming their men up to assault. This is the entire Union 2nd Corps being massed for this attack. But they, of course, do have some planning that goes into this. Although the officers and men are often somewhat in the dark, quite literally and metaphorically, they do lay out some plans. At 7 p.m., the evening of May 11th, Winfield Scott Hancock calls a meeting of his three division commanders. Francis Barlow, John Gibbon, and David Bell Burney. Hershaw Mott is not present because his men are detached. Their plan, as Hancock delivers to them, is to attack the Confederate right flank at daybreak the next day. Barlow wrote, "We were told that it was a movement of more than usual importance, and we were reminded of the gratitude which the country would feel for those officers who should contribute to the success of the enterprise." But there is no clear information on the critical details, the details that these officers needed to hear. Those of you who are with us as we talked about Emory Upton's attack on May 10th realize that the clarity of detail given to the officers and given to the men is critical to a successful attack. But here, these men do not know what they are supposed to do. Barlow said no information whatever was given us as to the position or strength of the enemy, or as to the troops to be engaged in the movement, or as to the plan of attack, or why any attack was to be made at that time or place. Which leads us to ask, just what did they actually know? In Hancock's report, he said the direction in which our troops should advance was ascertained by a line determined by a compass on the map from the Brown House, which was a staging area not quite a mile away, toward a large white house known to be inside the enemy's works, near the point we wish to strike. So who's feeling confident about this plan? We have a mark of a compass leading to a White House that we know is in the inside of the works. Any volunteers? Not so willing, I see. Union forces clearly are lacking knowledge about the Confederate lines in front of them. Where we're standing is the closest that any of Union soldiers have gotten to the Confederate lines. And this is Gershom Mott's attack on May 10th, which as you may know, was repulsed almost out of hand by Confederate artillery packing the mule shoe saline. That does not necessarily bode well for this attack. If this line is the farthest that any Union attack had gotten, and it failed miserably. The guides for this movement are Lieutenant Colonel C.H. Morgan, the Inspector General of the 2nd Corps, and Lieutenant Colonel G.H. Mandel. What's interesting is that these staff officers who are the guides also know extremely little. They don't really know where they're going either. They don't know the character of the ground for the attack, which makes planning extremely difficult. They are to coordinate with other corps as well. This is not simply to be a 2nd Corps massed assault. The other corps are also supposed to engage. Ulysses S. Grant said that Warren and Wright should hold their corps as close to the enemy as possible to take advantage of any diversion caused by this attack and to break in if the opportunity presents itself. So Grant is always looking for a weak point. Here, he says that if this attack is not enough to break the Confederate lines, everyone else should be attacking as well, or looking to take advantage of any confusion on the part of the Confederates, any weakening of any other point on the lines, so that they can charge forward in an attack likewise. So these other corps, particularly the 5th and 6th Corps, are to either attack or be prepared to move elsewhere and attack. The 9th Corps is also, on the far end of the line, supposed to make demonstrations, or to attack vigorously if they can. So this attack is primarily launched by the 2nd Corps, and we generally think of this as being a 2nd Corps attack, but it does take on a life of its own, and eventually begins to incorporate a large number of men in the 6th Corps, and the other corps are making demonstrations or attacks along their lines. So as these men are planning their march, Frank told you that men of the 2nd Corps had a long march ahead of them, from one end of the line essentially to the other. They'll arrive in place about 2 hours after they start, a long night march, and they'll arrive about midnight. They'll have a meeting at the Brown House that I mentioned earlier that is off behind you. Barlow goes in to meet Lieutenant Colonel Merriam, who also had been in the attack on May 10th. And Merriam, in that failed attack, is going to draw a sketch on the wall of the Brown House, laying out where this attack should go, what the Confederate lines look like. But keep in mind that he's never been farther than you all are standing. So you can look out on the Confederate lines and see about as much as he knew. These men know that there is wide open ground, and they need to march straight forward to the Confederate line. But beyond that, they don't really know. Which fills these men with anxiety and anticipation. As they stand on the edge of a massive assault, they are still trying to ascertain these critical details that they feel they need to know. Barlow, in command of essentially close to half of this attack, sarcastically asks, as he's trying to get information, whether there was a 1,000-foot ravine between him and the objective point. When he could not be assured even on this point, he seemed to think that he was called upon to lead a forlorn hope, and placed his valuables in the hands of a friend. Upon leaving the Brown House, Barlow's aide observed, he acted as if it was indeed a forlorn hope he was to lead. His voice was subdued and tender as he issued his orders to the staff for the formation of his command, very different from the brusque and decided manner usual for him. So we see an interesting thing here in that the kindness of this officer is seen as unusual, and actually a very bad sign. It's alarming to his staff that he is being nice. Usually he's jeering at them before he sends them into an attack. For Union troops, the night march is exhausting. Then it becomes comedic in its ridiculous nature. Then it becomes extremely sobering as they reach the jumping off point and realize they still know very little about what they are about to do. We have officers and men who are veterans. This is not their first go-around. But they are sobered by what they are looking at. They're not usually easily dismayed or frightened, but this attack alarms them, not only in what they do not know, but in what they do know. As they're looking forward, as they're massing their assault, they realize this is a desperate situation. Something is different about this attack. It is not the usual attack that they are used to leading. and that is very frightening and very alarming to them. During the meeting, Barlow proclaims that the organization of his line is that his division will form in two lines of masses, which means that Barlow is going to, in some ways, play off of... Did I just cut off?
Yep.
Oh, sorry.
There you are.
There we go. Okay. Can everybody hear me again?
Yeah.
All right. So Barlow, sorry about that. Nope, gone again. That's...
Battery?
May have lost battery.
All right. We forge up.
Okay, are we back?
Yeah.
All right, that's... Nope. No. All right. Okay. Then we're back to my voice again. I hope you'll bear with me. Can everybody hear me at this volume?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. All right. So Barlow proclaims that his men are going to mass, that they're going to go forward in a very dense column, similar to that Emory Upton used on May 10th. Bernie, David Bell Bernie to the right, is going to spread his men out in a linear formation, which leads us to an attack that looks an awful lot like a hammer that is going to hit the very tip of this mule shoe salient. Barlow decides that his dense formation is better. He said our solid formation was better adapted to quick marching and to a final rush than was the long line of Bernie's division. Barlow again, perhaps influenced by Emory Upton's attack. He said, if I am to lead this assault, I propose to have enough men, when I reach the objective point to charge through hell itself and capture all the artillery they can mass on my front. So as this hammer blow begins to be prepared to fall, it is set to move forward at 4 a.m. 4 a.m. in our time would be just after we started this tour, about 5:11. The attack is delayed due to excessive fog until 4:35 a.m., which would be about right now. This attack is stepping off. How do you feel?
Worried.
I heard hungry, and I heard worried. Hungry, I can't help you with. But the anxiety, I can say, was felt by many. Hancock will very soberly, very somberly say to his men, to your commands. There is no inspiring speech. These men know what is coming, and they are not happy. So note the very solemn way that all of these officers approach this attack. They have a great fear that their men will not be coming back. As they move through this area, they hit the Confederate picket line and keep on going. Hancock's report said that the attack from here, it continued up the slope, about halfway to the enemy's line, when the men broke into a tremendous cheer, and spontaneously taking the double quick, they rolled like an irresistible wave into the enemy's works, tearing away what abattis there was in front of the entrenchments with their hands, and carrying the line at all points in a few moments, although it was desperately defended.
As the night proceeded, Confederates out in front of you could mark the progress of the Union march across their front from left to right. But Ed Johnson's division in front of us had a unique experience because the Union sound of march stopped right behind you and built right in front of you. In the course of the night, Confederate pickets on this ridge became deeply concerned by the prodigious amount of noise emanating from those woods. They woke up a brigade commander, George Hume Stuart, Maryland Stuart, and dragged him out here to listen. And what he heard was a cacophony of voices, a full medley of thousands, and it sounded to him like a waterfall of noise. There was a large buildup in front of him. He is the first to recognize that this is no longer a Union retreat, This is massing for a major assault. And the one thing that that Confederate line out there needs is artillery. And this begins a tremendous bureaucratic ongoing battle of its own. Maryland Sturt went back into his lines to the McCool farm and woke up his division commander, Allegheny Ed Johnson, and dragged him out to the line, and sleepily they listened to the waterfall as well. Once Ed Johnson was convinced, he sent off to his Second Corps commander. They woke up Richard Stoddard Ewell at the Harrison farm and asked for the artillery back. And as of Richard Ewell wound up talking to Robert E. Lee to ask for the artillery back. And Lee assured him that all the intelligence says that the Union Army's retreating. But Ed Johnson persists, and Richard Ewell relents. He sends off for the Confederate Second Corps Chief of Artillery, Armistead Law, and orders the guns back. Long is going to wake up about 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, and sign off to have that artillery brought back. 24 guns that are necessary in the tip of the mule shoe. By the time that order found that Confederate battalion commander, Thomas H. Carter, Carter was 2 miles from here. He was down below the courthouse at Spotsylvania, and his horses were unharnessed and grazing, his men scattered and sleeping. He endorsed the order that it was 20 minutes before daybreak and that he would get his guns moving as fast as possible. As much as Robert E. Lee did not want to engage in a foot race, the foot race that brought him here, he is now engaged in a foot race anyway. It is a question whether the Union Second Corps will arrive here first or the artillery will arrive in those earthworks out there. The morning is close. It is dark. It is diffused. The rain has let up to a fine mist. There is a ground fog that swells and fills this area. Visibility is about 35 to 40 yards. In any direction. You can make out big things, like tree lines, but all other details disappear. As the Union soldiers move forward at this very moment, 150 years ago, they are launching the biggest, seemingly surprise attack there is. 19,000 men billowing up through the woods. They have no artillery announcing their attack. They are coached that there will be no firing until they capture the Confederate line. And above and beyond all things, there will be no cheering until the line is taken. Stealth until the last moment. And as they advance out of the fog, they meet the Confederate picket line disposed on this ridge where we stand. And the first shots of May 12th, they will touch off a firestorm that will consume us for the next 22 hours, begins here. Those first shots will start off to your left, down around the Landrum House, just inside the grove of trees. Union soldiers, unable to determine the strength of their opponent, open fire. As you heard from Beth, Union soldiers have been told that they're attacking a ridge, and that is where the Confederates are located, We are on a ridge. This is a ridge with Confederates on it. And as Union soldiers swarm this spot, they begin to cheer. Across the way, Confederate soldiers have been vigilant all night long. They know what is coming. They anticipate the attack. They anticipate their artillery. They have tried heroically all night long to keep their powder dry for this moment. They don't know when this moment was coming, but they knew it was coming. And at this moment, 150 years ago, in the fog, in the mist, this entire ridge explodes in cheering and fire. It is so profound that at least one of the Confederates out here on this picket line insisted that it was as loud as a cannon. And he was convinced that the Union Army opened with artillery. Because in the fog, the sound is magnified. He said that the fire was so close that he literally, instinctively, grabbed his head because he was sure it had been shot clean off. Other Confederates along this ridgeline can hear the fire, can hear the cheering, aren't exactly sure of how it all is coming together, but they also notice other phenomena. Over in the woods over here, to your left front, Confederate pickets cannot see the Union soldiers, but they see birds and owls come fluttering out of the woods en masse and cross over top of them. At this hour, that is like all nature gone awry. And for the more astute Confederates, it would have been a harbinger of what they had done just 1 year ago in Stonewall Jackson's flank attack, when they were like beaters to the hunt, driving the wildlife before them. Now, their roles are reversed. Union soldiers swarming this spot, Confederates falling back from this spot, or cut off from getting back to that main line. But it's the astute Union officers who realized seizing this spot came far too easy. This cannot be the objective. And as they peer into the fog and look into this morning, they discern that there is another ridge. And on top of that ridge is fresh turned dirt. They have not reached their objective yet. We need to get across this field. We need to get into that tree line. And we need to do it quickly. In 1864, the Confederates across the way have been waiting for this moment. And for the Union soldiers here, they have just announced this moment. They're ready, and we have an open field to cover before we can get to them. This is a direful moment in this opening movement. Union soldiers, up to this moment, have been deeply distressed. One Union soldier said that they entered into the woods behind you with a funeral silence. And when they got on this ridge and they erupted, that was a cathartic release. And from here on out, everything is rushing with adrenaline and instinct. Officers have to work very quickly to stay ahead of their men and to keep a semblance of order. To proceed there. That is our objective right now.
Ready?
So with that, we are going to proceed in the footsteps of Winfield Scott Hancock's Second Corps.
White sand out here. Brilliantly executed assault.
How far is it back to the ridge?
Back from that ridge to this one, you've got about 200 yards tops.
Wow, not too far.
Nope. Only got a couple of seconds.
Executed assault. Your alignment was perfect. Especially for a riot. But not that far off of what the experience might have been in those very footsteps that you just trod. Lieutenant John D. Black, 145th Pennsylvania, adjutant of the regiment, came across this ground 150 years ago before you. He wrote of this experience. He said that the men taking it for granted that that ridge back there, this was the enemy's works, and contrary to orders, opened the yell that always accompanies a charge, and they sprang forward. But on mounting the crest out there, the red earth of a well-defined line of works loomed up through the mist on the crest of another ridge, distant about 200 yards. And there was a shallow ravine between, which is where you are standing. This ravine is critical to their success. He wrote, "We moved quickly forward, and just as the command reached the bottom of the ravine, there belched forth works a volley of shot and shell that fortunately was trained on the ridge that we had just crossed." So this is where the main Confederate line will open fire on the Union attack. But they are not firing on the people in the middle of an open field. They are firing at that ridge back there. So the bullets go right over our heads. And nobody gets hit down here. Now, 19,000 Union attackers screaming their heads off with a demonic fury. How could the Confederates miss? The fog, the mist, the diffused atmosphere. They cannot see it. They can hear it. And what they heard was on that ridge. And as it ventures down into the bottoms, the grounds around us consume it and mute it. So that the Confederate doesn't fire at a visual target, They fire at an audible target. And they miss this opportunity. That shot that they had been husbanding all night long, waiting for this. The critical mass of the first shot. And it has gone awry. It is down here that General Barlow is again going to infuse his men and order them forward as fast as possible before they get a second round, before they get a chance to adjust and realize their mistake. Life is in the essence of getting up this slope as fast as possible 150 years ago. At this moment, Union color bearers step to the fore and try to vie with each other to get their colors on top of this ridge, on top of the Confederate earthworks first. There are at least three color bearers that are in a dead heat, in a full sprint, heading up this ridge, trying to make sure that they are the first. Regimental commanders are infusing them and their men, not only to stay with the colors, but make sure no one gets in front of New Jersey. Make sure no one gets ahead of Pennsylvania. No one gets ahead of New York, including the other color bearers. So as they roll from this spot, General Barlow will have every single officer under his command, repeating his order. Forward! Double quick! Charge! And with that, this bottom is going to empty out. The enemy awaits, but salvation is also there. To stay where you are is death. The only way you succeed to tell about it is if you capture that hill. 150 years ago, that was the life and death decision of this very moment. And the Confederates are furiously reloading, waiting for this group to come out of this bottom. That's what awaits us. Onward.
You guys should have come on stage with us.
We have two guests.
I
think second Delaware probably. They lost.
You need an extra guy to help you, please. Pick one.
Two lines that were worked here.
How are you doing?
One up at my scan area here, one lower.
That way,
the angle.
We'll be interesting.
Yeah. Uh-huh. I'm very serious about it, but I don't... Yeah.
Pretty good this morning. Mm-hmm. I would say that.
Was your great-grandfather married when you get here, or did you get married back?
I don't know.
Well, they told me that. They told me.
He enlisted in 61, but he'd been in the whole time.
So how old is
he? I don't know.
Well, that, I guess that's true because you're early enough to be here before you have to check in. I also was reading you co-author.
Right there is great Grant's great great grandson in the blue hat.
Blue gray.
John.